Hey.
Hey, Lizette, how are you?
Good. How are you?
I'm well. Happy New Year.
Happy New Year. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for being here. And to everyone starting to join, thank you guys so much for being with us today. My name is Meg Storm. I'm the editorial director here at Edit. And I'm really, really excited because we are kicking off a very special 4-week series today with the lovely woman sitting here with me.
Oh, thank you.
So excited for this. Every Wednesday this month, we're going to be going live and comparing some of the most popular in-office procedures to their at-home counterparts. So you can hopefully start off the new year with a really new and great skincare routine. So Lizette is going to be joining me all month long, which is so great. And we've
I
been.
know, I'm so excited about it. We'll be discussing all my favorite topics because I love in-office procedures. That's like one of my favorite things.
And I just feel like we've been talking about this for so long. So the
I know,
fact
we
that
really
it's
have.
finally here is just so exciting. For anyone who doesn't know Lizette, she is truly just like one of the best skincare experts in the business right now. I really believe
Oh,
that.
thank you.
She is an aesthetic RN, an injector, and just all around skin guru. Her handle, if you're not following her already, is Lizette Ludwig underscore RN. And I feel like your feed, in addition to like your precious family and all of those fun photos, is
Aww.
just such a great resource, I think, for skin. And I feel like we have a lot of synchronicities in terms of just trying to educate people as to what works best for them.
Yeah, exactly. Well, my name's obviously Lizette Ludwig, and I have been in the medical aesthetic space for about 12 years now. And I think just from being in this space, I've realized, you find your niche and the things that you are really passionate about. And one of mine is skin. It's become, the skincare procedures. And I also offer injectables to my patients as well, because I think combining these in-office procedures with injectables is like, it's really where it's at. It's like that brightening and everything settles in and you just get that glow. But my true passion is really the skin treatments, because when patients see how, and just, overall followers, when they're talking, just when they're following skincare routines and things like that, I think when you really see the change in your skin, I think that's when things really change. And skin really affects how you feel about
It
yourself.
does. It a
So
100%
I think it
does.
really makes a difference, and just to see how happy my clients are when they see the results or the time they've put into their skin.
Absolutely. And I feel like we're starting off with the perfect topic because we're starting off with something that really is universal and super versatile for all different skin tones and types.
It
So today's topic for everyone watching is going to be comparing professional microneedling to kind of its at-home equivalent, which is usually called derma rolling. And what I will say before we start is, and I'm sure Lizette would agree, it's important to kind of talk to your provider, your dermatologist, an expert like Lizette, before you kind of introduce any of these things into your own routine, especially the at-home side of things.
I
But
agree.
we're really going to talk about the safety and the efficacy of, how you might start to consider whether or not this could be good for your skin and for your needs. So I feel like we should start on the professional end of the spectrum. And I would love to kind of hear, I know microneedling, you told us, is one of your favorite treatments across the
It
board.
really is.
So I would love to hear why.
So yeah, it's one of my favorite treatments. So I'm excited it's our first topic. And the reason is it's because it is for all skin tones and really for almost all skin types and skin tones, and with minimal downtime. That's what I love. And I think that is what patients love about it too, is the results. You're pretty much immediately glowing for after a treatment. I mean, you're red for about a day or two, but
Okay.
the results really do start kicking in quickly. I would say within a few days, you'll already notice a slight improvement in your skin. So I would say that's why I love the treatment the most. Minimal downtime,
Yeah.
results are quick. And also it's for all skin types. There are very few treatments that you can really do on all skin types. The one time I don't really recommend it for patients is when they have a lot of active acne.
Okay, I was going to ask if like skin lesions or acne or any of those types of
Yeah, or
things.
even like inflamed, like eczema
Okay.
or psoriasis. If it's really active at the time on your face, I don't recommend a microneedling treatment because it can spread things. If you have acne and then you're just kind of opening the lesion and then spreading the bacteria,
Yep.
that's not really a good idea. So one zit isn't going to hurt anything. Usually I'll
Yeah.
go around it.
Okay.
But yeah, that's the only time I would recommend waiting for the microneedling treatment is when you have active acne or, an active rash or something like that on your skin. But other
Great.
than that, I mean, really, it's great for all skin types. And like I said, there's very few things that you can do on darker skin types with like at treatments. So yep. These minimally invasive procedures have really, you know, they've been on the forefront for darker skin types.
Which is great. And yeah. I just want to encourage everyone watching, if you guys have questions as we go, please feel free to drop them in the comments or use the little question button and we'll be sure to answer them as we go along. Yeah. I think in terms of, I know it really is kind of a jack of all trades, but it can address fine lines and wrinkles, right? Because you're essentially wounding the skin to kind of kickstart a healing process.
Exactly. So essentially, yes. Yeah, so it helps with fine lines, it helps with wrinkles, it helps with pores. And just more the appearance of pores. It doesn't really change your pores because that you can't really do, but it definitely helps everything look smoother on the surface of your skin. If you have sun damage, uneven skin tone, those are all things that it can improve. Not with one treatment. It definitely takes multiple.
Yeah.
And usually I recommend about 4 to 6 treatments spread out about a month apart, 4 to 6 weeks apart.
Gotcha.
But I mean, with each treatment, you'll notice about a 15 to 20% improvement in your skin.
Great.
So you'll see results with each treatment, and it almost encourages you to want to do more.
Absolutely. You know? Yeah. And if you have, I mean, obviously we don't have as many big events these days as we may have in the past.
I know.
If you have something, even if one of these coming up that you know, want to look great for, how far in advance do you recommend someone starting?
Well, if you know you want to do a series, which I recommend, I would say start a few months before, at least try to get 3 in before before your event. But sometimes I'll have brides come to me like a month before their wedding. I'm like, oh no, we can't do that much, you know, but I might do like in that month, I might do like, I'll try to squeeze in 2 microneedlings if we do like, you know, cause even if you give yourself, depending on the way you react.
Okay.
But normally the downtime is 1 to 2 days of redness. And within like the 3rd or 4th day, your skin will feel a little dry.
Yeah.
But that's really it. I mean, the dryness, I don't consider that downtime because you can really cover that up. That's easy. You just moisturize, you know? So normally I say 1 to 2 days of downtime. And if we can squeeze, you know, if you can squeeze a couple in, but like in a month, you can, but I normally recommend spreading them out about a month apart.
Okay.
So it just depends on how many you plan on doing. But if you have a big event, I would say at least try to get 3 in before your event. So plan on 3 to 4 months before.
And then microneedling can be combined with platelet-rich plasma. It can be combined with kind of extras to boost its benefits, right?
Which I love. That's another thing that I love about this treatment. You can combine it. I typically just like to combine it with PRP. In the beginning, when microneedling first came out, I think we were experimenting with putting peels on top, and I've found that is really irritating for people's skin, and it does have a lot more downtime and trauma. And sometimes the results are great, but sometimes it can cause things like hyperpigmentation and stuff. So I find it's not worth it. It's better just to play it safe and use a PRP. The PRP is basically using your own growth factors from your own blood. So you'd come in, we do a blood draw. We take the liquid gold from the top. That's what we call it, because a lot of times people think you're putting blood on my face, but it's growth factors in your blood that are actually separated in this little vacutainer. So so then we use that, and then we use that as a serum as we're doing the microneedling. So we're infusing that serum deep down into the dermis. And then the other beauty of the PRP is you can inject it as well.
Yes.
So for people who don't want to do filler, I mean, the results aren't as long lasting as filler, but personally, I love it for like my under eye area.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. I love it for areas where you don't really want to, you know, they're just more delicate to the filler.
Definitely.
And sometimes if people have really thin skin, it's a lot easier to see filler in that area. So yeah. I love it for under eye. And then sometimes this area is really good. I mean, you can really inject it all over. It's just such the PRP is so awesome, especially for anyone who's just really scared to do filler. I think PRP is a great option. But the nice thing is, you might as well, since you have the PRP, you might as well have a microneedling as well.
And just double up.
And you can do it both, you know, same day.
Which is great. And then microneedling isn't just for the face. Obviously, it does wonders for your face, but you can use it on your body as well, correct?
Yes, you can use a microneedling device on your body. And I've actually seen great results with stretch marks from, you know, treating stretch marks.
Yep.
It does take multiple treatments.
Okay.
Usually that I could say anywhere from 6 to 8 treatments. And we do have to use a stronger setting. So it might have a little more downtime. You might have a little more redness in the area because we do have to treat it a little more aggressively. But I've seen great results from microneedling treating stretch marks and even older stretch marks too. It's been
interesting.
I've treated everything from newer stretch marks to older stretch marks, and
it works for scarring as well.
It works for scarring too. I've seen the best with scarring. I mean, scarring is such a tricky thing, you know. Yeah. But it definitely will help improve the scar. I wouldn't say it's going to get rid of the scar, but it'll improve the texture of the scar. But it's great more for like acne scarring where it's like discoloration and things like that. It's really amazing. But once you have that, we call it ice pick scarring, where it's like much deeper scarring. I do think microneedling will help just look, make the skin look smoother, but you may need something like a laser
to actually change the texture and even it out. Gotcha. And so when it comes to the treatment itself, it usually lasts about an hour, right? Because there's the numbing involved first.
Yeah. So there's a numbing process. So when you come into the office, typically what we do is make sure your face is clean. So we'll, you know, wash with soap and water. That's my favorite. And then we'll do a wipe. Like I like to clean with witch hazel, and then we'll put the numbing cream on, and you let the numbing cream settle for about 30 minutes. And I mean, the numbing cream, literally it makes the treatment feel like a facial massage. Like it
love
thank
that.
Goodness for the numbing cream, because I've had it with numbing cream and without numbing cream. And it really, if you do the 30 minutes numbing, it's not painful at all. Like you feel like you're relaxed.
Awesome.
If you don't use the numbing cream, you can definitely feel it feels like pinpricks or something like that. So I highly recommend the numbing cream. Sometimes people don't like the way numbing cream feels.
Yeah.
It feels funny when your face is numb.
Because your face is
numb. Sometimes people don't like that. But even if you can get it on there for 15 minutes, it takes the edge off. So I highly recommend using the topical numbing cream. Then we wipe the numbing cream off, and then we do the procedure. If we're adding the PRP, we usually draw the blood.
Okay.
When you're numbing.
Yeah.
And then we use the PRP. I will say, though, when you do the PRP and you do the PRP injections with it and the microneedling, you will have more downtime.
Okay.
Because if you're injecting
absolutely
the PRP in, you'll be a little more swollen, a little red. So just keep that in mind.
And then when it comes to the treatment itself, if you're not using PRP, do you put any kind of serum on the skin prior to microneedling, or does that come afterward?
Yes. So typically what we do is we have, you know, in-office serums that are designed for microneedling or, you know, post-laser treatments, because you do have to be careful what you put on your skin. You don't want to use like anything that's like, you know, like exfoliating, like, or even some like retinols. I know sometimes people will use vitamin A on top. We'll talk about that when we go over to the at-home stuff.
Yeah.
But honestly, I found the best thing to do is just use a serum that's more healing. So like hyaluronic acid. If you're going to put, I don't even recommend using a moisturizer. I recommend something like an elastin skin nectar. And a lot of times actually these, and I'll show you the skin pen kit, which is usually, the microneedling tip, comes with a little serum. Usually always the in-office one comes with a little serum, and it usually has hyaluronic acid and healing peptides.
Okay.
And that's what you want to do. You just want to keep it simple. You want to, like we like to say, is just kind of seal the deal, because if you think about those little, micro wounds are open. So you don't want to let anything in there that's going to get trapped and irritate your skin. Like vitamin C can do that. They did find that vitamin C was, you know, leaving little bumps in people's skin.
Interesting. Okay.
So you do have to be careful what you put on. I usually say less is more. So just use something really simple, like a HA serum, like a hyaluronic acid serum, or listen to your provider. Usually we have great in-office serums that are made for these procedures.
And you should be really diligent. I mean, with sunscreen always, but especially after a procedure like this, right?
Yes. And normally we say use a mineral sunscreen after microneedling. Sometimes, well, when you put a chemical sunscreen on after a procedure, it can burn because of the chemicals in there. So you just want to make sure, you know, that you're using what your provider is recommending. Because we have seen people that I would say is the biggest thing that we are concerned about with microneedling is what patients do when they go home. And that really affects the downtime, you know, because skin irritation is a real thing. So if your downtime is really only supposed to be 1 or 2 days, but you get home and you decided you want to put your serum on, that has retinol, vitamin C, or, you know, we don't know. And all of a sudden, your skin's going to just fire.
Freak out. Yeah.
It is. And you're going to have a, you're going to get irritated. You could even get, if you have darker skin type, like myself, like I'm Hispanic, so things can irritate our skin really easy. And so if you're a skin type, I would say 4 or so, you can even cause melasma type things. So you have to be really careful and really listen to your provider. And if they're recommending a serum, like for example, I usually recommend this Skin Nectar by Elastin.
Okay.
It's worth purchasing.
Yeah.
Because even it's a, you know, it's a one-time purchase and you'll use it for all your treatments and you have it and you want to use it for a few days after. So it's definitely worth purchasing that after take-home serum. And, you know, you can always use it. A lot of times it's just nicer when your skin's feeling dry or irritated. Definitely. It's not like, So that's my recommendation.
It's a good investment. Yeah. And then I know you mentioned you have the skin pen with you. So that's typically the type of device or the type of tool that's being used in office for one of these procedures.
So typically this is what it looks like. It's just, it's kind of boring, but
it almost looks like an electric toothbrush on the
bottom. And then it has, so it has, that's how you, you know, you push the on button.
Yeah.
Now when you purchase the pen, it comes with these little kits, and that's what I was saying. Like it comes with the serum.
Gotcha.
And they usually all do. I've used different ones, but this one is the skin pen. And this is one of the only pens that's FDA approved, because a lot of microneedling pens are not FDA approved. So and it comes with this little sterilized stamping needle, if you can see that. And it has little numbers here. And that's how you would determine the depth of the needle.
Gotcha. Okay.
So you want to make sure that in areas, for example, like your forehead, you're not going to treat as aggressively as you would like your cheek, you know? Or, for example, how we were talking about the stretch marks. You can go really high on the stretch marks, like 3 millimeters. Whereas like you would never do that on your forehead, you know?
Right.
So there's, when your provider should know what depth to go in each area. Every area has a depth. And so you want to be conservative in the areas like under eye. And that's the other thing I love about microneedling is you can really get close to under the eye.
Okay.
There's very few things that you can use under the eye. So it really helps those fine lines under the eye.
But also really kind of drives home why you need to go to someone who knows what they're doing, because this is using needles
you
on your face and under your eye.
Yeah. So then the serum, it then after your treatment, if you're using the PRP, put the PRP in. Usually the provider will tell you leave it on for like 4 to 6 hours.
Okay.
But if you have the serum, they'll, you know, give you the serum or ask you to purchase, and you want to make sure you just use that the day of. Usually your little you know, the open micro wounds will close up within a couple hours, but you still want to just take care of yours. You don't want to like introduce any bacteria or anything like that.
Absolutely. And then we had a question come in about kind of hyperpigmentation and melasma and concerns like that. Do you think that microneedling can help address some of those things?
Absolutely.
Okay.
It can. However, I have seen that you have to, melasma is a very tricky thing. A lot of times it's internal and it's hormonal. Okay, so the things that we are doing, like topically, will certainly help. And what I usually recommend is, and I try to prepare my patients for this, it's kind of a long run. So you may need more treatments, because we can't treat as aggressively as we would for someone who's treating wrinkles, you know, that's not prone to melasma. Because melasma is tricky, where you can really inflame it. You know, you
can make it worse.
Inflame the skin and make it worse. So you have to be really careful. So usually I say less is more. The treatments are usually more conservative, and on a treatment plan as well as to what they're doing at home. So we may get them on some topicals or lightening ingredients, but absolutely we can. But I have also seen cases where patients have had really aggressive treatments when they necessarily didn't need it, because maybe people aren't aware that you're not supposed to treat those areas conservatively, and it can really inflame melasma as well.
And
so with go ahead.
No, you go ahead. You finish.
So I usually say with melasma, less is more. With hyperpigmentation, that's a different thing. You know, with hyperpigmentation, meaning like if you just have some hyperpigmentation, like from acne scarring or something like that, you can, that you don't have to worry about as much. But it's the melasma that gets triggered.
Okay.
If you don't treat it, you know, conservatively.
Great. And then in terms of needle depth, that was another question that came in. Okay. So I know it's different depths, as you were saying, for different treatments. What's the deepest that the skin pen can kind of penetrate?
This one goes to 3 millimeters. I rarely, actually 2.5, and that it goes a little past 2.5, but that's as far as I
would go.
And that's usually for stretch marks or deep wrinkles.
Okay.
And I would only use like a 2.5 on the face if it was like those ice pick acne scars or deeper wrinkles. But other than that, I don't go full blast on the face. It's just not worth it. I've seen things, you know, where you have more downtime or you inflame melasma or you cause pigmentation.
Right.
So the best thing is to treat conservatively and kind of work your way up. Usually face, I like to stay at in these areas here, like 0.5 to 0.75 in the upper face.
Great.
Around the crow's feet, you can go a little more. And then lower face, I usually say between 1 and 2 mm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Perfect. And then obviously you're kind of doing that. I mean, I feel like to your point about less is more. And then you're going to be coming in, you know, for a series of 4 or 6, and you're going to see those great results without as much downtime after
and
each
usually
one.
And usually I'll go up like 0.5 or 0.25 per treatment based on what, you know, patient's feedback.
Definitely. Okay. Yeah. So now that we've covered microneedling, let's move into the derma rolling end of the spectrum. So I, similar to you, I have a derma roller here. This one is from Julep. It's their new Slowpoke roller. And so I think one of the obvious differences, obviously, is that most of the at-home versions tend to be more in this roller form than the kind of more pen-like form that you have.
Exactly.
And then obviously, I think you guys can hopefully see it's a lot tinier of a needle, and it's all one. There's no kind of customization there. It's all kind of the same depth throughout.
Exactly. So the derma rollers, it is kind of a hot topic because especially right now with all these at-home treatments, you know, I have to be honest, they're not my favorite for a couple of reasons. I feel like, I think if it's someone who's really experienced with skincare.
Yep.
And who has been doing microneedling treatments and really understands what these treatments can really do. I think for those type of patients or those type of people who are really into beauty, the derma rollers might be okay for them.
Okay.
They're still not my favorite. I still recommend if you're going to do an at-home treatment, I would say look for the ones that are like stampers.
Okay.
They have them. They actually, I think they're coming out more and more.
Cool.
Where they actually, instead of rolling, because think about it, when you're rolling like that and you don't know how fast you're going.
No.
You don't know. It's very uncontrolled and it really can cause tears and actually more trauma than your skin can handle, you know? And there's no, it's like, sometimes I see it on Instagram and people are like going like that. And
really
like,
hard. Oh! Yeah.
Yeah. Really hard and really fast, you know? And you just see your, because these are all micro tears or, you know, little micro wounds.
You're
so it's like
your skin. Yeah.
Yeah. And it just looks red. So it's like, it doesn't, but when you really look at what it can do, it's like a very uncontrolled injury where it's can cause more damage. I think that if you don't know what you're doing, it's probably, this is one of those where it's better left to the professionals.
Yep.
But again, if you're like, if you're someone who's really into skin and can really, I would say if you really, really want to use a roller, roll it slowly.
Okay.
There's no need to go really fast or find the stampers because the stampers really can control the injury and you're not.
It's very concentrated. Yeah.
Exactly. And the depth of these at-home treatments are like 0.25. So it's very minimal, but you can still cause some superficial damage.
Yep.
So it still is, and you're still, oh, and that's what the other thing that I worry about is then you're stamping, or even if you're stamping or rolling, and then we don't know what you're putting on at home. So
that was going to be my question, kind of what if you are kind of doing this in a really controlled way. Obviously you want to clean your skin first.
Yes. Always. And once you're freshly washed skin, for sure,
super clean skin, and then from there, should you put any kind of serum or oil on, or should you roll?
I would not put oil. I know oil is like such a big thing, but and I do love some oils, but I don't think it's really something to put on when your skin is has those open little, you know, open little wounds in your skin. I really just don't think it's a good idea, because if your skin closes over, you're sealing in that oil, and it can cause a little clogged pore or granuloma, or you just, it's just, so I would say more of like, I was recommending like these you can find these peptide serums. Like, I keep going back to Elastin, but that's really one that I found has worked so well.
No, it's great.
And it's called, it's called Skin Nectar, and it's truly like so healing for the skin. So you want to find more serums that are healing. So they might have, like I was mentioning, hyaluronic acid. Honestly, you also don't have to do much. You really don't. I mean, if you really want to use these treatments, sometimes they come with serums.
Yep.
And you can use the serum they're recommending, or you can just kind of not, you don't have to put anything. Think about it. Your skin's already doing, your body's already doing what it's supposed to, which is make more collagen and elastin.
Yep. All the things that your skincare might help do anyway. Yeah.
Exactly. So there might not really be a need to put anything on if you can use some patients, and these are patients who I've, you know, they've done multiple microneedling treatments. We may put like a retinol pad over. So you can do it. It's just, I wouldn't recommend doing it the first time, you know, your first treatment. You got to see how your skin's going to react. And I wouldn't recommend necessarily doing it if it's like a new serum. If it's a serum you've been using for a long time and you're, you know, do a little test spot. That's what I always recommend. Try it, you know, do a little test spot. So you can technically put a little vitamin A over, but you just have to know your skin.
I think that's what it comes down to. It's just like, there's no, you're trying something new potentially. So I feel like the rule of thumb for me, at least that I've always heard from people, is try one new thing at a time. You don't need to overwhelm your skin with a whole bunch of new.
Exactly. So if it's like your first time you're using the derma roller, I think just use the derma roller, just use the stamper, because you don't know what your skin's going to react to when it comes to just using it. You don't have to put anything over it. Your body now is going to start making more collagen and elastin on the surface. So let it be. See how you like the results. And then kind of, you know, if you have the next time, you might want to try it in a little spot, you know, that type of thing.
And then in terms of whether you're using the roller or the pen, do you kind of recommend upward motions and kind of a light pressure, or what would be your recommendation?
I mean, essentially, you know, because you think about the jade rollers, right?
That's what I was thinking.
You're supposed to be rolling down. A lot of people roll up, but your lymphatic drainage system is really down. Yeah, it's supposed to be up and down. With microneedling, I mean, you're not doing it for lymphatic drainage, but I would say up.
Okay.
You know, I would say roll up. I think that's a better idea.
Okay.
Or stamp up, you know.
Right.
But you're going to want to do, like, for the stamp, if you're doing the stamp, you're going to stamp up. You're going to want to do little like patterns. So you go up and then down. Because typically you want to do, normally I do about 4 to 6 passes. But that's for the in-office treatment. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So I'll go over the area about 4 to 6 times. Again, with the at-home treatments, I don't really know what they recommend. So it might just be 1 to 2 passes.
Okay.
So you might want to do one up and then maybe one down.
Okay. You know? And then would you say, if you're just starting out, maybe once a week at most to start to see how your skin responds?
I would say once a week. Yeah. I would say once a week. You don't want to do it too much, because it's like exfoliating, you know, you want to just keep it minimal, like 1 to 2 times a week is enough. You give your time, give your body the time it needs to make that collagen and elastin. And usually that's about 7 to 14 days.
Great. And then we had a question come in asking about the difference between microneedling and microdermabrasion. Do you have thoughts on kind of one versus the other?
Yeah. So they're completely different. Microdermabrasion is more exfoliation.
Yeah.
So there's different types of devices on the market. So like Hydrafacial is one of them, where it's exfoliating. And I think that's, I love microdermabrasions, but like with anything, you have to be careful, right?
Yep.
You don't want, especially with those patients that have melasma. So I would say microdermabrasion is more of an exfoliation, and the microneedling is more of a collagen type of stimulation on a deeper level.
Great.
So there, you can do both. Like, I've had patients where I'll recommend sometimes that they do microneedle, and then maybe the next one will be a microdermabrasion or a hydrofacial, and then maybe another microneedle. When you're targeting different layers of the tissue and the different depth, that's when you start really getting that glowing, wow, like you're really targeting every layer now, you know?
That's great. It's kind of like an all-in-one little.
Exactly. It's like, you know, it's like anything. When you do the same thing, like after you do your series of microneedling, you're probably not just going to keep doing microneedling.
No.
Then I would recommend maybe doing them, you know, a few times a year, just to kind of maintain, and you'll know when you're ready, maybe once a year for like that full session again.
Yeah.
You know?
And in terms of, I know you said if you're doing the in-office treatment, you could potentially do PRP injections the same day. Do you ever do regular filler injections the same day as a microneedling treatment, or do you usually separate those out?
I like to separate them because when I do filler, I really just like to see what I'm working with.
Yeah.
When you do microneedle, you can get a little puffy and a little swollen. And I certainly don't want to do filler and then microneedle over.
Definitely.
Because you just don't want to, it just doesn't make sense. So I typically like, I know you can do it on the same day. It's okay. It's just not really something I prefer to do because I like to really see what I'm working with when I'm doing a filler treatment.
Makes sense. And then one last point I want to make on the at-home side is just the importance of sterilizing the device in between uses, right? To make sure it's totally clean. And I know you had a really great tip about not just cleansing it, but then putting it in alcohol as well to really sterilize it as much as possible.
Yeah. So for initially, right after you use it, just put it in soapy water for 10 minutes or so, just to kind of really get rid of all that debris, you know, the skin debris.
Definitely.
And then after that, you can disinfect with alcohol. But the alcohol is not really going to get that debris off, the skin debris. You know, it's just disinfecting it. But you want to make sure that you're cleaning it as well. So you clean it first for about 10 minutes in soapy water and then disinfect with alcohol.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Great. Well, for anyone who wants to learn more about all of this, we actually have an article up on our website with Lizette where we deep dive into this topic today. So you can head on over to Edit's Instagram page and you'll be able to find the link to that article if you want to learn more. And we're going to embed this video there as well so you can catch up on anything you might have missed. And as I mentioned in the beginning, we're super excited because this is the first of four of these that we're going to do. Next week, same time, Wednesdays at 2 p.m. Eastern, 11 p.m. Pacific, we're on different coasts, which I love.
I know.
We're going to be discussing the difference between actually exfoliation, ironically. So we're going to be talking about chemical peels versus at-home exfoliators, which I'm super, super excited to talk
excited
about.
For that one too.
I feel like that's one that, again, like all the buzzy things right now, we just so happen
to really
be talking
is.
About.
With all these at-home treatments, we're trying to see what we can do, you know, at home versus going into an office. So I'm excited 100%. For next week.
Awesome. Well, Lizette, thank you so much for this. And thank you to everyone who joined us. And we'll see you guys next week.
Bye, guys. Thank you.
Thanks. Bye.
Take care. Bye.